So I'm going to talk about joint work with two people, Mikhail Ershov and Gili Golan. Gili is a student at Bar-Ilan now. And so this is about a kind of new subject, although the origin is in the 30s, but it was essentially ignored for some time, for quite some time. So the definition is very easy, and it's the basic definition of non-amenable groups, which was mentioned by Nicolas Manot before. It's the definition due to Tarski and von Neumann. So you have a group G, and you have you say that it is equidecomposable with a set A, with a set A subset of G, if A is a union of n pieces, disjoint union of n pieces, and there exist G1 translating elements Gn such that the union of Gi Ai is equal to G. So then we say that G is equidecomposable with a proper subset. So we assume that it's proper. And then we say that, okay, so G is non-amenable, the group is non-amenable, if it is equidecomposable with two disjoint subsets. Right? So it means that you have a piece of G, we can rearrange the pieces to get the whole G, and we have a disjoint piece of G, and we cut it and rearrange and get again the whole G. For example, yeah, and the Tarski number, so suppose that it is, yeah, it's equidecomposable, like of degree n, and suppose that we have two subsets, one equidecomposable with G of degree n and another one of degree m, then n plus m, the minimal such n plus n, is the Tarski number of G. Okay, so suppose that we have also B, and so we have B is equal to B1 union Bm, and there are translating elements H1, Hm, is also G. Then the minimal such n plus m is a Tarski number of G. So it's a basic definition. So there are several known facts. The first one is due to Hausdorff, I guess. It's if you take a free group with two generators, we can take like A1 and A2. A1 is a set of all words starting with A, A2 with a set of all words starting with A inverse, B1 and B2. So B1 starts with B, B2 starts with B inverse, and then what we have is that A1 union A2 is equal to G, and B1 union B2 is also equal to G. They're disjoint, and so the Tarski number of the free group is at most 4. And it is easy to see it's exactly 4. Why? That's because you see from the definition, it immediately follows that if you have a translating element G1, Gn, then if you multiply this by the same element, like by G, it's again a translating element. Because if you multiply group G by element G, you get G again. Right? So the translating elements are not uniquely defined, but so you can multiply all translated elements by the same element, it's still translating elements with the same pieces. So in particular, we can just divide by G1, and we can assume that G1 is equal to 1. So we can assume that G1 is equal to 1, and we also assume that H1 is equal to 1. Right? And it means that N and M must be at least 2. So there must be at least 2 elements. You cannot decompose with translating element 1. So that means that the Tarski number of any group is at least 4. So for a free group, it is exactly 4. And every group which contains free group, non-amenable, non-abelian free group, is Tarski number 4. So F2 is inside G. The Tarski number of G is 4. Now, what was proved by two students of Tarski, not at the same time, though. The two students of Tarski, and Tarski gave them apparently the same problem. and they both solved it. So one of them was Bjarni Jonsson. Actually, he became a famous logician. And another one is Decker, which I don't know him. I don't know what he did anyway. So but they both proved that it's if and only if. The Tarski number is 4. It's if and only if F2 is inside G. And the proof is not difficult. The thing is that suppose that we have this decomposition, and we have translating elements 1G and 1H. Remember, I told you that, so we can always assume that one of the translating elements is 1. So it's 1G and 1H. Then we can define a ping pong table. And the ping pong table is A1, A2. It's one side, B1, B2, another side. And it's easy to prove that G, so H moves this thing into this part. And any power, positive power or negative power of H gets from here to here. And every positive and negative power of G gets from here to here. It's very easy to prove. And so we have a ping pong and G and H. So the player H goes, player G goes from here to here. And G goes from here to here. I don't remember right now. I mean, maybe vice versa. But anyway, so G and H generate a free group. Right? So that was the result like in the beginning of 50s. There was not much more known till 99, when there was a paper by Cetirini, Silberstein, Grigorchuk, and Delarp, where they proved several things. It's a long paper. In particular, part of it is devoted to Tarski numbers. And they proved, in particular, a connection between Tarski number and spectral radius of a group. So if you know that spectral radius is very close to if you know the Tarski number is very large, then spectral radius must be close to 1. Also, a relation between spectral radius and cogrowth. And they estimated Tarski numbers for some groups. For example, they proved that the Tarski number of any torsion group, if you have a group which is torsion, it's at least somebody tried to break in. Okay. Anyway, so that if it is torsion, then the Tarski number is at least 6. So torsion group at least 6. That's not a big deal either. So that's not a difficult statement. But they also estimated Tarski numbers of known non-amenable group without free subgroups. In particular, they proved that for Bernstein group, where M is, so M generators and exponent N, N greater than 665 odd, then the Tarski number is between 14 and 6. So 6 is from here. 14 is from estimation of cogrowth. And estimation of cogrowth was actually given in the proof by Adian. So Nicolas Manon, when he was talking about this, he said that this paper of Adian is very, very, very complicated. And it is true for some papers of Adian, but not for this one. So the paper where he proved that this group is non-amenable, it has two parts. So the first part is just essentially compilation of some results from the previous long paper. And the second part is result about groups having what's called den presentation. So if a group has infinite den presentation and it satisfies some very mild properties, like a growth of this presentation, how many words you have, then the group, he proved that the group is non-amenable. And in fact, he computes the co-growth. And from that co-growth and the estimation from the Grigorchuk and Delap, it follows that the Tarski number is at most 14. We still don't know what this number is, so it's between 6 and 14. But at least we know some estimate. And they also ask some questions like, what kind of Tarski numbers, what kind of numbers are Tarski numbers of groups, and so on. Now, there are several observations you can make almost immediately. So the first thing, the first observation is due to Ozawa. He asked this question on math over flow. The observation is this. So if you have this decomposition, then G's and H's together must generate a non-amenable group. Okay, so 5 seconds should be enough to prove it, because if you just take the subgroup generated by all the G's and H's and intersect it with this decomposition, you get decomposition of the subgroup generated by G's and H's. So it must be non-amenable. And the second observation, which is a little bit more complicated, and we proved it in our paper, is that separately, G's and H's separately, they generate infinite subgroups. So G's and H's, so the subgroup generated by G's and subgroup generated by H's, that requires maybe more than 5 seconds, they're infinite. And Taka Ozawa asked whether there are groups with arbitrary large Tarski numbers. For example, it was known, not known if there are even groups with arbitrary large Tarski numbers. And I answered that question immediately, because I also added like two and two together. Like this observation, I didn't know this. But I knew about results of Misha Ershov and prior results of Golan. And in fact, the answer was known at that time already, but it didn't appear in any written way. So what Misha proved, together with Andrei Haikin, they proved that so-called Gold-Shafarevich groups are non-amenable. All of them are non-amenable. Now, Gold-Shafarevich groups, were introduced by Golan and Shafarevich in 64. It was for the first solution of unbounded Burnside problem. And in particular, in one of the papers by Golan, he constructed a Golan-Shafarevich group. I will explain what Golan-Shafarevich groups are. But he constructed such a group where all, say, it has, like, for any k, there is a Golan-Shafarevich group where all the group is k plus 1 generated, but all k-generated subgroups are finite, in fact, nilpotent. These groups are, in fact, they satisfy kind of angle condition, but not bounded angle condition. They were first examples of angle-infinite groups, unbounded angle. Infinite groups. So, okay. So, if such a so you take this group, it has like all k-generated subgroups are finite. That means that the Tarski number. So, you see, the Tarski number must be at least 2k plus 4. So that means immediately implies that there are groups with arbitrary large, non-amenable group with arbitrary large Tarski numbers. So again, it follows from this construction of Golan and the result of Ershov and Haikin. There are groups with arbitrary large Tarski. But in fact, if you look at the paper by Ershov and Haikin, they proved much more. So they proved a very remarkable result, in fact, which is the following. So there is a group G, which is Golan-Shafarevich group, I will explain what Golan superiority is later, but doesn't really matter. So there is a group G, which is non-amenable group, such that for every K, there exists a finite index subgroup of G, where all K-generated subgroups of K of HK are finite. So you take any arbitrary large K, there is a finite index subgroup of G where all K-generated subgroups are finite. Okay? Now this sounds very fantastic, this is not very difficult. I mean, if you use like hyperbolicity, this geometric group theory, this is really impossible. I mean, so, but for Golan-Shafarevich, this is a standard kind of argument, and I will explain why. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that G is non-amenable. Of course, this is Golan-Shafarevich. It's non-amenable by Ershov and Haiken. Finite index subgroups of G have arbitrary large Tarski numbers. Okay, so in particular, there exists a number T, whatever this Tarski number of G is, such that the property of having Tarski number T is not quasi-isometry invariant. So T of G equals T is not quasi-isometry invariant. This is an interesting thing. Why? It's because. There is a famous question of Benson-Farr, whether the property of containing free subgroup is quasi-isometry invariant. It's not known still. It's very far from being known. So that would mean that Tarski number 4 would be not, or I mean, the question is whether Tarski number 4 is quasi-isometry invariant, and it was not known for any Tarski number. But now, I mean, from this example, it follows that yes, there are. But of course, the estimate of T, I mean, we can estimate the Tarski number of G using the cogrowth of spectral radius, but it's an enormous number, something like 10^8. So it's far from being 4. That's what I'm saying. So it makes this Farb's question even, I think, more interesting. We still don't know what the answer is. But OK, so this is about what was known before. So let me explain what Golan-Shafarevich groups are. Let me try to. Okay. I cannot use this board. But let me explain what it is. It's very easy definition. Unfortunately, I don't have time, but I would otherwise I would. Explain the history. The history of Golan-Shafarevich groups is actually really fascinating. That goes back to Fermat and the Fermat last problem, in fact. There is a very nice survey article by Misha Ershov published in IJAC about Golan-Shafarevich groups. So here is what it is. So we take a free group. Say if it's two generators, and we pick a number, prime number p, then there exists a Zassenhaus filtration of F2. Now, what you can do, I mean, that's a sequence of subgroups of finite index, which is finer than the lower central series, right? And it's also, you don't want to give the definition of Zassenhaus series. What you need to remember is that if you take a commutator of any two elements, then it goes deeper in the filtration, and if you take an element and you raise it to the power p, you also get deeper. This is a normal subgroups. They're all normal series, and all the factors are elementary abelian P groups. Okay. So then with every element W, you can associate, also pick a number, say you call it eta, less than 1, greater than 0. And then with every number W, you can associate its weight. With every element, with every word W, you can associate its weight. You look at the first member of a Sachsenhausen series which does not contain W, and suppose that its number is I. GI doesn't contain W. So this is equal to P to the power, so nu to the power I. Right? So nu to the power I. So that's weight of an element, of a word. And then you can define a weight of a collection of words, just a sum of weights of the words. And then you can define, say, for example, you have a set of defining relations of some group. You can define the weight of this set of defining relations. And you can, the interesting thing, the Golan-Shefferovich quantity is this. So you take weight of the generating set. Right. It's not necessarily F2, Fn, minus weight of the relations, minus 1. So that's this quantity is kind of deficiency of a group, with weighted deficiency of the so deficiency of the group is the number of generators minus the number of relations. So here is a weighted version of that. Okay, and the statement is, so Golan-Shefferovich groups are groups for which this is greater than 0. Okay, so if it is greater than 0, you get Golan-Shefferovich group. And what is known about Golan-Shefferovich groups is that they're all infinite. It was proved by Golan, essentially. Although Golan not really considered this particular groups. It was defined, I mean, he considered very closely related groups. I think groups exactly like that were introduced by Koch. It's also related to like infinite Galois groups and so on. But anyway, so it is easy to prove that they're infinite. What was proved by Ershov and Heiken is that every such group has a homomorphic image, infinite homomorphic image, having property T. In particular, these groups are non-amenable. Now, okay, so remember, if you take hyperbolic groups, then you can do lots of things with hyperbolic groups by taking their quotients, right? So you take hyperbolic group, you take a random word, you kill it, you get snow, again hyperbolic group. Here it's much easier than doing that, because you see, if you take a word, we take this, suppose this relation is true, we add a relation of very, very small weight, which means that relation is deep, very deep in the Dassenhaus series. Then it's still true, right? And so the group is, again, infinite. So you can impose relations and produce, again, infinite groups. Also Golan-Shefferovich groups. In particular, you take a bunch of elements, right? Suppose that the weight of these elements is less than, total weight is less than 1. Then you impose very long commutators on these elements, right? I mean, this finite number of elements, you do very, very, very long commutators, kill them. What you get is that this element generates an important subgroup. Now, you also add big powers, like x to the power p to the power of whatever, in almost infinity, that's very close to a large power. And you impose this relation, so you get these groups are finite now. It's a finite, it's a p group. So that's, you take any finite number of elements, you can make the subgroup generated by them finite. And it's still Golan-Shefferovich. What you can do, and what they do with this Heiken and Ershov, what they do, you can do it with, you take all possible, all finite subsets, and you can do that by taking, okay, so you pass to finite index to make all your subsets which you want to kill of weight less than 1, and then you kill them using that, and then you pass to, and so on. So, the result that I quoted, which sounds really fantastic, that you can have a group where like finite index subgroups have K-generated subgroups finite is not that fantastic, and completely self-contained proof is in, I think, Appendix C in our paper. It's also in the paper by Haiken and Ershov. Okay, so this is nice thing, and let me introduce two classes of groups now. That's for every K. So amine K is a class of groups where all K-generated subgroups are amenable, and fin K. It's the same thing, but all K-generated subgroups are finite. Okay, so clearly, like amine one is the class of all groups, and fin one is the class of all torsion groups. Okay, so what we notice is that for every k, amine k, and in fact fin k, contains non-amenable groups. They contain Golan for every groups. Okay. Now, the interesting question—I mean, you immediately observe here—is that if you have a group from amine k which is non-amenable, then it must have at least k plus one generators. Right? It must have at least k plus one generators, and the same with fin k. So the question is, maybe Tarski number depends on the number of generators somehow, right? So maybe in order to get big Tarski number, you need to have big number of generators. And the answer is no. So that's a theorem, kind of really new result, that the first new result that we prove is that for every k, there exists a two-generated, you can actually assume that it has property T. Two-generated group with a Tarski number greater than k. Now, how to do it? You take your group, you want to embed it into two-generated group, and Laurent Bartholdi explained how to do it. We use very similar construction. It's due to Neumann and Neumann, right? So, but the construction is essentially this. So you take group G, for example, from fin K, with many generators, and you take the risk product, essentially, not exactly, but it doesn't really matter, risk product with a large cyclic group. And that's where this subgroup of that will be what we want, right? Subgroup, actually finite index subgroup of this will be what we want. The problem is, you see, okay, so when we take a risk product with finite group, it's a semi-direct product of the direct product of G with a cyclic group. Okay, so if G belongs to, like for example, fin A, fin K, then this thing also belongs to fin K, and so this has large Tarski number. But when we start doing the extension, it's not completely clear what happens when we do extensions, what happens to the Tarski number when we do extensions. But then we proved that in fact you can control Tarski number of extension, but in general, if you take a group G and you take extension of it by some finite group, the Tarski number actually can decrease, and the decrease, the quotient between Tarski number is actually at most, we prove at most, the index of the extension. And so, you see, this is, say, belongs to fin K, so Tarski number at least, whatever, 2K plus 4, then we extend it by cyclic group of order K, and the Tarski number drops to 2, I mean, whatever, to the constant, right? Because it's, so the real theorem that we prove here about the extension is this. It's called, let's call it theorem 1, that's how it's called in our paper. The theorem says that if you have a group G, and it has a subgroup H, with index actually is finite index, then the Tarski number of G minus 2 is smaller than, Tarski number of H minus 2 is smaller than Tarski number of G minus 2 times the index. So this is actually a nice formula, which was the first kind of starting point for our, which is Schreier, kind of Schreier index formula. And look, the Schreier index formula, this is the number of generators minus 1. And of course, number of generators minus 1 is the true rank of a group, right? Because the Tarski number is also, of course, not the number of pieces, but number of pieces minus 2. Because, I mean, the 2 of the translating elements are equal to 1. So actually, this is very similar to the Schreier index formula, right? But it doesn't help here, because okay, so this is large Tarski number, but when we take the semi-direct product with the cyclic group, it gets smaller. So what we proved, actually, it's a theorem two, is that sometimes, for example, when this factor is a cyclic group, this can be much improved. So we can say that Tarski number of H minus 2 is at most function of Tarski number of G minus 2, where function only depends on the class of groups where this thing. So we, in this case, we consider like variety of all groups, of all abelian groups. This variety satisfies, I mean, all abelian groups, satisfies two properties. So it consists of amenable groups. All abelian groups are amenable. And the free objects in this variety are left orderable. So the free product, free abelian groups are left orderable. So if this is true, then there is this function f, which is essentially the Follner function of the free object of this square of this function, such that this is true. So if h has very large Tarski number, G must have also very large Tarski number, that's how you get the two generated property T group with large Tarski number. We also proved some other things about Tarski numbers of extension. For example, we proved the following result, that if you have G and we have a normal subgroup which is amenable, normal amenable subgroup, then the question was what's the relationship between Tarski number of G and Tarski number of G over N? They're the same. So this is nice. Right? So this is kind of classical thing. I don't know. So when we started, we didn't expect anything like that. This is neither this nor that. So this is a non-obvious fact. And the last thing which we proved, we tried to prove that the Tarski number of direct product, direct, say, square, is the same as the Tarski number of G. We cannot prove it. Cannot prove it, but it is smaller than, say, Tarski number, essentially Tarski number of G squared or something. So we expect that it's just equal to Tarski number of G, but we don't know how to. It's an open question. Okay, so this is our theorem, one of the main theorems. The second main theorem we prove is that, okay, so we know that free group has Tarski number 4. There were no other numbers which were known to be Tarski numbers of 4. So first of all, from this example of Haiken and Ershov, it follows that something similar to this Bertrand postulate works for Tarski numbers. Namely, you take a group G, which they construct, and for prime number P, for some prime number P, let's take P equals 2, and take the Sassenhaus filtration for that group. It's an easily finite group. So you have a sequence of subgroups. Each of them is index 2 in the previous one. So when we pass to index 2 subgroup, the Tarski number can increase only by a factor of 2. So it means that for arbitrary sufficiently large n, there exists a Tarski number between n and 2n. Because when you get to index 2, I mean, we know that it increases arbitrarily large, right? And so between n and 2n, I mean, when you multiply by 2, eventually you get between n and 2n. So again, we don't know if, for example, number 5 or number 17 or the number 24 is a Tarski number. And in fact, it took us some time to find another Tarski number, which is number 6. So it's a theorem. There exists a group G with Tarski number equal to 6. It's a torsion group. And the group is actually known. It was constructed by several people. For example, this is the same group as the counterexample to Gilles Pizier's problem about non-unitarizability problem. So the problem was that like groups without free subgroups, which are non-unitarizable, and it was proved that I think it's Epstein and Mano, that if first L2 Betti number is greater than 0, then the group is non-unitarizable, and you can construct a torsion group with first L2 Betti number greater than 0. That was constructed by several. For example, Osin constructed such a group. It's the same group. It has Tarski number 6. So what we prove is this. So in fact, the example is this. Take take G to be generated by A, B, C, by three elements. And suppose that first L2 Betti number of G is greater than 3/2. Such groups exist. It's Osin proved that. Then the Tarski number of G is at most 6. And of course, if it is torsion, then it is 6. Right? And the proof is this. So let me explain. I have a few minutes, so let me explain how the proof goes. First of all, we can reformulate the definition of Tarski number in the graph theoretic way. So remember that we have this A's and B's, and this translating elements like G1, Gn, H1, Hm. So consider the Kelly graph of the group G corresponding to G's and H's. And let's look, suppose that this is like green and this is blue. So we have a Kelly graph with n plus n generators. I mean, we don't necessarily assume that these elements generate the group, but we still can consider Kelly graph. And the edges have two colors, green and blue, right? Now, what happens is that, so since we know that G is equal to GI AI, and it is equal to HI BI, what we know is that this graph has a subgraph such that every vertex has n plus n outgoing edges and exactly one incoming edge. Right? So you just take the sub, essentially, no, you basically take a Kelly graph with respect to GI inverse. That's what you, and HI inverse. So you see that every element, if you take any element A from G, it is connected to AIs using this GIs, and it connects to BIs using HIs, so it's a green and blue edges. And we have this property. Anyway, so we have a graph, a subgraph of Kelly graph with exactly G plus N, so exactly M blue edges coming out, and exactly N, it's not true. So it is exactly one blue edge coming out, exactly one green edge coming out, and exactly one edge coming in. Okay, so that's exactly equivalent. If the number of labels is n plus n, that's exactly equivalent to having Tarski number n plus n. Just look at the Kelly graph. So what we want, you want to find a subgraph of Kelly graph. Just remove some edges from the Kelly graph to obtain a graph with this property. So we have one H of one color, another H of one, of another color, and so going out, and one thing going in. Now, if you studied a little bit of combinatorics, you immediately recognize such graphs. You get such graphs when you apply the so-called Hall marriage lemma. Although for Hall marriage lemma, you have exactly one thing going in, one goes out. So you marry every female to one male and every male to one. But here it's kind of marriage with for polygamists. So every male wants to have two wives, and every wife must marry to only one man. But there is a theorem exactly like this. So if you have, and the theorem, the whole marriage theorem says this. So if you have a property that every finite subset A, if you take the positive boundary, so the number of edges coming out of this A, is bigger or equal to 2 times the size of A, then you can arrange this. You can arrange marriage. The polygamist kind of marriage. Every guy is married to two women. Okay? And that's exactly what happens here. So we want to do that. We want to arrange this marriage. Of course, this is kind of non-standard because we don't really know where the males are and females, but it doesn't really matter. Because actually some of them actually are married to themselves. But anyway, so that's what we want to do. We want to have that the positive boundary of every finite subset has a lot of vertices, like at least twice. And that's what this condition allows us to do. In order to prove it, you're using what's called the Russ-Lyons lemma. If you have L2 beta number greater than 0, then you can, there is so-called the uniform spanning forest, which is kind of measure on the set of all forests, measure on the set of all subgraphs supported on forests, and the expected degree of every vertex is large. In this case, it will be greater than 2. Okay, so expected degree of every vertex is large, but then if you take a finite set, you integrate and you get the boundaries at least twice. This, okay. So now that means that you can get this marriage. Now you also have to arrange that one of these edges is blue and another one is, so you have to color the edges so that for every vertex, one of the edges is blue and another one is red. But this is also another is red, but it is also can be arranged because look, so we consider two subsets, one AB and one, say, AC. If you take any two elements, one A, B, and C, one A, B, and C, if you take any two elements of them, then we can also, we always arrange that one of them is in this set and another one is this set. Right? So if it's obvious. But that it means that we can actually color, so just arbitrary color so that we have two colors in this case. And you see the number of translating elements is 1 ABC. So you get that the Tarski number is going to be 6, right? 3 plus 3. Right? Okay, so that's how you do it for this case. Now, the open question is, so we kind of conjecture that here you can actually assume that the L2 beta number is at greater than 0, and it's still always less than 6. What is known is that there is a result by J.C. Peterson and Andreas Thom that if you have a group with positive L2 beta numbers and torsion free, and also there is some minor thing about Atiyah conjecture, which it must be true, right? Otherwise, what's the point? So there is so Atiyah conjecture must be also true, then the group actually contains free subgroup. Torsion free group must contain, in fact, more than that, but in particular has Tarski number 4, torsion free. So for torsion groups, should be true that if it is greater than 0, then it should be at most 6. We don't know how to prove it yet. With or without Atiyah conjecture, we don't know. It must be true. And it is possible to prove that all groups with large Tarski numbers, which we consider in our paper, have L2 beta number 0. It is possible to prove. So one interesting thing is about Bronsted groups, whether they have L2 beta number 0. Now, that would follow if Shalom's conjecture was true, that Bronsted groups have property T, because nobody believes that, and I had a hard time to convince my co-authors to include this conjecture in the paper, because they say this is cannot be true. But it is we write in the paper that it's hard to believe that, but there is this conjecture which nobody can disprove so far. So that so if Bronsted groups have property T, then of course L2 beta numbers are equal to zero. There is another thing which would imply that L2 beta number is zero, but it's maybe even harder conjecture by Zelmanov. It is related to this restricted Bronsted problem. But anyway, so what I want to say to conclude is that so this theorem that I formulated, for example, this theorem, it shows that these Tarski numbers are actually interesting objects, because you can prove the nice results about them. And also, it, like this theorem shows that we know almost nothing about them. So we know that Tarski number 6 exists, but like 7 or 5 or 28, we don't know anything like that. And so, I mean, I would just invite everybody to work on this. And thank you for your attention.
Much indeed. So, questions, comments?
What is the conjecture of Zelmanov? What is the conjecture of Zelmanov?
The conjecture is this. So if you take a group, suppose that you have a group which is torsion, bounded torsion, and suppose that every two generated subgroup, say torsion of exponent p, p is prime, and suppose that every two generated subgroup is finite. Does it imply that the group is finite? So he proved that if you replace 2 by number which is sufficiently large, depending on p, like exponential or something, I mean, then it is finite. And the conjecture is that it's number 2 should be enough. So we don't know.
I do have a question. So in that theorem there, when you construct two generated groups with arbitrary Tarski number, how do you get property T?
You start with a group with property T. Mm-hmm. The group is property T. Then, since this is finite, it also has property T. And the group
that you may assume that G has property T.
We can assume that G has property T, because this Golan-Poincaré array group, you can assume that it has property T by Heiken and Ershov.
Okay.
Is there Tarski number for stable groups?
Yes, there are, of course. No, nobody considered. A free semigroup, it's 4. I mean, whatever. No, it's not 4. I think it's 2, I guess. Or 3 or something. Because there is no identity, you cannot just divide by. For semigroups, you can also define it. I don't know really what for free semigroup. I think it's something like 3 for free semigroup.
More questions? Laurent?
Have you tried to estimate the Tarski number of the Frankenstein group?
That's a question which we don't, I mean, the Nicolas Manot, right, group. We don't know. It may be 5. It may be 5, because it's non-torsion. But I don't know. We don't know. It may be something. I don't know. There is also this group by which we constructed with Alexander Alshansky, which is non-amenable group, which is torsion bicyclic. So the Tarski number of this group, we also don't know. It may be also 5, or at least it is kind of should be solvable whether it is 5 or not. So.
Assuming that Thompson's group is non-amenable, is there any estimate on the
No.
More questions? Well, if not, let us thank all the speakers of today.